stop everywhere.
Welcome back to Next Stop Everywhere, the Doctor Who podcast. I'm Charles Skaggs, back in the TARDIS once again with my two favorite partners in time, Jesse Jackson and Karen Lindsay. Welcome back, guys.
Hello.
Everybody ready to talk some Doctor Who?
I have some aliens with me.
Can I talk now? I was told not to talk.
Oh, yes. Don't
listen to the smarty pants.
I am being don't a JA. Yes, I am being a JA. Hey, yes, I am very excited to talk about Doctor Who. Always love talking all things Who with two of my favorite people.
All right. So, another big episode, guys. The aliens are multiplying on Karen's feed, in case anybody's wondering what we're talking about. She's got finger puppets, y'all.
Yeah. I had two, and then I put on a third one, so they were... I'm sorry, it's so dumb. I'm sorry.
No. I'm used to that.
Yes, I know.
Jesse may not be used to that, but I'm used to that.
Yeah, I know.
That's all right. So we're going to talk The Ghost Monument for episode 120, written by Chris Chibnall, directed by Mark Tondorai, who's directed some stuff here in the States. And this is the second episode of Series 11, which aired just yesterday on October 14th, 2018, featuring, of course, Jodie Whittaker's second episode as the 13th Doctor. And I am looking forward to talking about this because lots of stuff happened in this one.
Yes.
Yes. So before we get going, what did everybody think about this episode? Jesse, you want to talk first about what you thought?
I loved it.
Yeah.
I was just as happy. I think the more I watch Jodie as the Doctor, the more I'm just charmed by her and enjoying her journey. I really like the interaction between the three companions. We got a little more character development. And we actually had three decent guest stars. So, yeah, I really like this episode a lot.
Yep.
Agreed.
And how about you, Karen?
A nice ensemble outing here.
Yes.
No one took the spotlight. And I like those. Not that I don't like the ones where it's like centric, but I kind of dig the ones where everybody kind of gets a little piece of the pie. We each got a little bit in there,
right.
I think. And we also got like some guest stars that were front and center as well, without taking away from the main characters. And, I think it was just super well balanced. The storyline was very rich and, I liked that there was big bad upon big bad upon big bad, which was very cool. And the planet that they were on was also a big bad. So it was just a very rich episode.
Yeah, I thought so too. And, we got some things teased this week. In addition to, we got the return of the opening credits. So very happy about that.
Yes,
the Rorschach credits. As I call
when
them.
I saw them, I went, okay, they will be so happy.
No, I thought they were awesome, but that little beginning part where it kind of looks like a Rorschach test, I'm like, am I thinking of my mother right now?
It's just a pulsating blob of energy.
It's
pulsating.
It
explodes.
It does kind of look like a Rorschach test, though. I'm not mocking it. I really like it. I especially like that boop kind of, you know,
Yeah, one of the things I liked was that it's kind of like an updated version of that kind of lava lamp style from the original 1963 Doctor Who credits.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Just kind of tweaked with some really cool special effects. And a great new theme arrangement, which also kind of harkens back to the original theme, more like an updated version by Sigun Akinola, the new series composer, taking over after Murray Gold. And I thought it worked really well. And I'm really looking forward to hearing this theme. And I think I found my new ringtone, you guys.
Did you?
Very nice.
I do like that boop, that kind of, you know, drop there when it goes into the
little pause, you like wait for the drop and then boom.
Exactly. And then they go into hyperspace. It's very cool.
Kind of like little opening bass line in the new theme, like emphasizing the diddly dum diddly dum diddly dum. Yeah. But it's more of a
super heavy.
And it's, you know, very modern take on the.
We only watched it like 100 times today, Jesse. Can you tell?
Yes, I can tell.
YouTube.
You guys are so happy.
YouTube, replay. Yeah,
exactly. I really liked it. It was kind of the cherry on top of the icing for this episode.
Yeah, as a Doctor Who fan, most Doctor Who fans, I think, are credit junkies. They just love the opening theme music. They love the opening credits, and they love to compare. And you see a lot of videos where they kind of like will either have them all together or they'll compare one against the other. And I'm sure this will be different here.
It gives the flavor. It kind of sets the tone for each Doctor.
Yes.
So I really do feel like it adds an ambiance to each Doctor's run.
Well, yeah. And Jodie Whittaker obviously has her own theme now. So, you know, her 13th Doctor Who theme. So which is very cool. And I think it's a kind of an improvement on the Capaldi titles. Mm-hmm. That's my personal take. I think I like the psychedelic effect with the credits.
Yeah.
If you're not going to go like a time tunnel type effect, vortex, then go the psychedelic route.
I
really like that.
Super modern looking.
Yeah. That was very cool. And finally got to hear the theme. So that was very cool too. So, all right. I know Jesse's like, credits, big deal.
Move along. These aren't the things you're looking for. Yeah,
exactly. So
they were credits. They were fine.
It's art, man.
I'm just saying it. The credits did not add one.
Yes, they do.
Second of pleasure.
They set the tone
for the story.
Credits are so important for Doctor Who.
Yep.
I think a few other of our listeners out there might agree with us on this one.
Absolutely. Oh, I'm always wrong. I know that.
You're not wrong. You're not wrong. You're right.
You're entitled
to
your opinion. You're entitled to your opinion, Jesse. That's no problem.
You're entitled to it.
I mean, I thought they were great. I mean, I thought it was a great, and it was good to see. I just don't need them to make because it is – to make a great story.
Right.
So, you
don't think it sets the tone for the show?
No.
To kind of get you in the mood? You know, like when you hear the Star Wars theme, you're like, yeah, Star Wars. That doesn't get you in the mood? Or the Superman theme to get you by John Williams. Doesn't that get you in the mood?
I like more when there's an action happening and I hear the, the Murray Gold... Doctor Who, or like in during a movie where you hear in the background, you hear the John Williams Superman theme.
Right. And you hear it swelling in the background.
Yeah. I don't need it on the credits. I just need it when, and like there's been Star Trek episodes where, all of a sudden you'll look and you'll hear the fanfare and you're like, that's cool. Just in the credits, it's like, it's the credits, but let's move on.
Okay. So let's talk about this guest cast for this episode because there are some notable cast members in this. And I know Karen wrote some notes and I know I wrote some notes. Mm-hmm. So why don't I start? And then Karen, if I miss anything, just jump in if you would.
Yeah.
Unless Jesse, you
have
notes as well.
No, we're good.
Okay. All right. So first person I want to talk about, Susan Lynch, who played Angstrom, one of our pair of rather shady looking humanoids, aliens. She was notable because she's been in a lot of notable movies. Ready Player One, for one, recently. Yes. She was in the Johnny Depp adaptation of Alan Moore's and Eddie Campbell's From Hell, mm-hmm. the graphic novel. And she was even in Interview with a Vampire way back in the day.
She was. Wow. Not a huge part, but she was in it.
No, but she's in it.
Yeah.
You know, you could say I was in Interview with a Vampire.
She was in an interesting movie called Beautiful Creatures early on mm-hmm. in her career.
Right.
And that was kind of a fantasy type movie. It was an interesting movie.
Yeah, it's more of like a young, that was for like young adult
yeah.
novel adaptation.
Right. That's where I remember seeing her first.
Right.
But Ready Player One, of course, was the most recent. She played the aunt.
The aunt. Yeah.
Yeah. And she looked completely different. I mean,
she's the one who gets killed horribly yep. in the explosion. Yep. She blowed up real good.
She did blow up real good. She's just a terrible person in that movie. So I'm okay.
Well, she wasn't that great here either.
No, I kind of liked her in
no,
this.
No, no. I think
her? You really?
Yeah. Yeah, she was, I think, the more sympathetic.
I mean, I liked her more than Epso.
Oh, yes.
That's not hard, though, I don't
think. She was the way more sympathetic of the two.
Yeah, yeah. Because it was, yeah, because we talk, you know, we'll talk about this, but, you know, she lost her wife mm-hmm. as a result of everything that went down. Speaking of Epso, Sean Dooley, who played Epso, he was most notably in Broadchurch, obviously Chris Chibnall's main claim to fame.
I wonder if that's how he got the job.
I'm guessing there's some yes. like little inside yeah. track there. He played Ricky in that, mm-hmm. and that's the UK Broadchurch, by the way. Right. And he also played Greg on Misfits.
Yep, I love Misfits.
Which is like a kind of like a like kind of hoodlum kids get superpowers kind of show.
Yep.
And juvenile delinquents, I should say, get superpowers.
Yeah, while they're on a, like a cleanup detail.
Yeah, exactly.
It's such an awesome show.
Yeah. And then Ark Malik, who plays Ilan, the kind of shady gangster guy that's running this race. He's most notably because he played a character named Cameron Shaw, who was a major supporting character in the James Bond film, The Living Daylights.
Ah, with Timothy James Dalton. Bond is back.
Exactly. We have another James Bond connection here. And he was also like in True Lies as like the main terrorist guy, I think. And he was also recently the prison governor in the Sherlock episode, The Final Problem.
That's right. He was in John Carter.
Right.
He was in Homeland. And he was in a very, very forgettable movie made by the author William Goldman of The Princess Bride.
Right.
Called Year of the Comet. And... Okay. It
apparently
is.
Wasn't that forgettable because you remembered it.
Yes,
isn't that about wine?
Yes, it is about wine.
I like that movie.
I do too. That is why I mention it. Yeah. I actually really like it. It stars Tim Daly. And it is Gigi, the guy who starred in Gigi. It is his final movie. So I liked the movie, but he is like kind of the baddie in Year of the Comet. So,
by the way, Susan Lynch was also in Killing Eve, which got a shout out the last time Charles and I talked.
Yes.
So,
yeah, we talked about on Titan Talk yesterday.
Yeah.
When we recorded that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, just briefly in passing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And excuse me. One final actor I want to mention is Ian Gelder, who plays the voice of the remnants, you know, those that kind of really creepy ghost like cloth monsters that's swirling around here. He's most notable because they're of a Torchwood connection, because he played a character named Mr. Decker on Torchwood Children of Earth, which of course starred Peter Capaldi in that
awesome.
As a guest star. And He also is most notable because he played a little character named Kevin Lannister on HBO's Game of Thrones.
Oh, okay.
Lannister.
So he's one of the Lannisters, yes.
Who will pay his debts.
Who will always pay his debts, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yep. So I thought that was kind of cool. Lots of pretty diverse acting resume for this group.
Mm-hmm.
But very interesting, very I think, cool. Nonetheless. Yep. All right. So everybody ready to dive right into our main topics?
Yeah, I have two general comments.
Okay.
First of all, an angstrom is an incredibly small measurement, like one thousandth of a. I mean, it's super small, right?
Yes. It's a measurement of mass, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when Ebso tells her she's nothing.
Right.
I thought it was really kind of funny.
And like a little in joke. Yeah.
Ah, very nice. I did not know that.
Yeah, good observation there.
Yeah, because it is soup. I mean, it is almost literally nothing. And then remnants are the name of those fabric monsters. And of course, fabric, what do you get them in when they're like off the rack and there's just a scrap left? They're called remnants.
Yep.
Hmm.
So like scraps.
Right. So
Scraps wouldn't be as intimidating of a monster name.
Right.
No.
I wrote remnants, fabric. I see what you did there, Chibnall.
Yep.
So
yes.
I thought that was like, funny.
Breaks out the road jay's thesaurus.
That's right. But I thought, you know, angstrom and remnants, those are kind of cutesy, winky sort of. If you get these references, then you're pretty smart. So.
Yep. All right. So let's dive into our topics this week. You probably guessed the theme. It's pretty obvious, I think, that I came up with. First topic, The Fast and the Furious.
Okay.
Ah, okay.
Racing?
The fast being Ryan and the furious being the doctor at Ryan.
Yeah.
So I want to talk about the doctor and the companions right off the bat.
Okay.
And so, Jesse, let's start with you. What was your take on Jodie Whittaker's second episode and the continuing development of her relationship with her friends, as she emphasizes in this episode?
So one of the things I want to get both of your feedback on is it appears that this doctor is a little more inclusive.
Right.
That the doctor is explaining things a little bit more. Not totally, but unlike past doctors where just catch up. You know, the 13th Doctor takes the time to say, okay, we're in a planet. It's going to be okay. You know, I've messed up, but we're going to be all right. And, you know, and I won't give it exactly because someone will have that quote. So I like that she seems to be very productive of her companions. She does think of them as friends. And she is still very confident. I love the line where she goes, have I not mentioned I'm really smart, you know, or something along that line. So I just really like their relationship. She seems to be not as flighty as Matt Smith, not as manic as David.
You mean a little more focused.
Yeah. And not as grumpy as Capaldi or Eccleston. She seems to be a little more on point, knows what she's doing, and seems to take a little more responsibility for what's going on. So I really like that change of pace. She's still the smartest person in the room. She's still three or four steps ahead of everyone else. But she's also almost like a teacher when the scene with the gas – you know, and she's talking about, hey, did you study this? What were the things, you know, and setting this up? I just like that dynamic a lot. Do you think this is different?
I don't. I mean, I think you're right that she's trying to get her companion / friends engaged in what's going on. And I think she's still kind of feeling out the dynamics a little bit.
Yeah.
And I think she's taken a particular interest in Ryan.
Yeah. But do you think it's a little different than what the past doctors have done?
What do you think, Karen?
Yes and no, I guess. It depends on the companion sometimes. She's definitely feeling Ryan out. I think she has more of a handle on who Graham is.
Right.
So
she doesn't feel like she has to watch him.
Right. So she's not acting the same way with him. And it seems to be that way through the years with the companions, that it totally takes on whatever life it needs to for each companion. But I think Ryan and the Doctor are going to have a special bond. I really do. If they can make it work.
Yeah. I think Ryan is essentially the 13th Doctor's main companion.
Yeah, I think so.
You know, like Rory was a companion to the 11th Doctor, but Amy was his main companion.
Right.
That type of thing.
Rory was Amy's companion.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah.
I think Graham and Yaz are Ryan's companions.
I could see that.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so too. But
they're kind of his entourage.
Yeah. But, you know, I kind of noticed that in the previous episode, toward the end, when the Doctor is watching Ryan's second attempt on the bike.
Mm-hmm.
And it was that kind of really long shot where she's in the background, he's in the foreground. She's in the foreground, he's way off in the distance. And she's just watching him. She's not doing anything else but studying him.
Right.
And so I'm just kind of like wondering, you know, if she's taking a special interest in him. And I think that's why she kind of gets a little upset with him when he kind of there's that one scene where he decides, well, I'm going to be like Mr. Call of Duty guy and I'm going to go blast these robots.
I've trained my whole life for this.
Yes.
Yeah. Karen could identify with that moment, I'm sure.
I don't think I would do that.
As a gamer, though.
No. Yeah, yes. That's pretty dumb to equate being a gamer with doing it in real life, though.
And I really, really loved the Doctor talking about bullets and being smart, and I don't embrace guns, so I that was really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, that's one thing I noticed, that it seemed like the Doctor's sense of moral outrage is still there.
Yes, which is good.
And I hope that never changes, because I think it's kind of important to kind of have the Doctor want to set that bar.
Yes.
And see who meets who raises up to meet that bar.
Right.
Yes.
And what happens when they don't.
But on the other hand, I hope they don't water down any because she's female.
I don't think they will.
But I'm just saying, let's not make her a bleeding heart. You know.
And I guess that was my unspoken question, is it because she's female, she seems to be a little more inclusive and a little more patient with her companions?
Well, I don't think so, because Peter Davison, the Fifth Doctor, he had three companions and tried to get them to get along as a team, but mm-hmm. a lot of the times they were bickering with one another.
Right.
Okay.
He tried
to be the peacemaker.
He tried. Because Davison's Doctor was essentially the calming diplomat mm-hmm. in a lot of ways. He tried to be the moderating force.
Okay.
To all of this chaos around him.
Yeah.
And I think Jodie Whittaker's Doctor is kind of capturing some of that a little bit.
Okay. Good.
Whether intentionally or not, I think it's happening.
You might have to with three companions.
That's true. Yeah. When you're the leader of the group and you're trying to, like, it's like herding cats, probably.
Well, yes.
That you're trying to get everybody, like, on the same page and, like, hey, this is life or death. We got to get you focused and think about what you're doing and don't go running off and almost get yourself blown away like Ryan did.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And not to mention she had these two other charges.
Yeah, like the pseudo companions.
Right. Mm-hmm. Even though they didn't really want her help, but
no,
they needed no. it.
Yeah, they kind of stuck along.
Yes, they did.
Hung out until it was like convenient for them to kind of wander away.
Right. Well, they needed her until, you know, they needed her until the end, which is, of course they did.
Yeah.
Dummies.
Yeah. And another thing I liked about this episode was there was some great subtle nods to the past, including the Doctor using once again her mastery of Venusian Aikido.
Yeah.
Thing that John Pertwee first initiated when he was busy like doing judo flips and whatnot on bad guys or what have you. And he referred to it as Venusian Aikido, and that's kind of stuck a little bit.
I did not know that.
Yeah. So that's kind of his thing that he started. And every so often there's a reference to a Venusian Aikido, and it was kind of nice to hear that again, I thought.
Good.
And the you redecorated, I like it. Yeah. Instead of the you redecorated, I hate it.
Yeah, it was a nice twist on that, which was a line originated by the second Doctor, Patrick Troughton, in The Five Doctors.
Yep.
And it's kind of been referred to, like Capaldi, I think, has done it. Matt Smith. No, it was during the Day of the Doctor or something. Mm-hmm. And I think
that
Tennant's Doctor.
Yeah, exactly. Made that,
it's been a few times, but yeah.
So it's there. So yeah.
But I like how she is happy with the changes.
Right. Exactly. It was a nice tool. Instead of I don't like it, it's I like it. I think I like this. Yeah.
Yeah. I liked it a lot that she was talking to the TARDIS and very happy to see the TARDIS. I will tell you, when I saw the TARDIS materialize, I did a Yes. Hands up.
Well, we're going to talk about the TARDIS here in a minute.
Okay.
Down the road. So save that. Save that enthusiasm. I want you to geek out hard over that. So. Okay. All right. So, anything else about the Doctor and the companions this episode? Oh, we did get a little tease we should talk about. We could probably talk about that when we talk about the remnants, because I do want to talk about the remnants a bit. All right, so never mind. I'll table that for now. Strike that, reverse it. Yeah. So anything else about the Doctor and the Companions before we go on to other topics?
I'm good.
All right.
Yeah, I'm good too.
Okay, second topic. Death Race 2018.
Racing movies.
Exactly. I thought it's pretty obvious, but
Death Race 2000 is much better.
Yeah, well, it's Death Race 2000, but this is 2018 where they're set. So, because they moved in space, not time. So it has to be 2018. And this is Angstrom, Epso, and Illen. Mm-hmm. So I want to get everybody's thoughts on these two characters and Illen, who basically, we find out Illen is the guy in charge of the Rally of the 12 Galaxies. So, Karen, let's start with you first this time. What did you think of these characters?
Well, this is the last Rally of the 12 Galaxies.
Right, right.
So one has to wonder why it is the last Rally. Why is that? Is that going to come back? Because we've already seen some stuff come back.
Right.
You know, is there something going on that this race is ready to pack it in?
That's a good question. It's a good question because we find out, we're told that there's like 4,000 original entrants in this race. And Epso and Angstrom are the only two remaining. Mm-hmm. And this is like the final leg of this race.
Right.
And it's kind of set up as like an intergalactic amazing race.
Right.
If you watch that show.
But it's not like their civilization's dying out because all of their clan is still alive.
Right.
And everything. It's just the entrants that have all perished, apparently.
Exactly.
But he does mention it's the very last race. And then, you know, hey, as a last shot, I'll split up the prize since you guys kind of have me over a barrel at the end. But yeah, he's kind of the worst.
Yeah. And,
didn't he say something about he was the first winner or something? He had something to do with the original race, but
yeah.
Whatever the deal is, he's terrible. And
because he tells them right off the bat, the thing is like you're competing for a ride home from this planet. If you win, you get off this rock. If you lose, you're stuck.
Right.
You're getting
abandoned. And you get all this money.
But you get all this money.
Right.
Right. In addition to getting off the planet.
And it means you and your whole clan get to move away and be safe.
Right. So, be comfortable for the rest of your lives.
So that makes me feel like, well, maybe this race that we saw last week.
Yeah.
Simcha's race, which were mentioned again in this episode.
Yes. Right.
Are they threatening the life of this civilization? And that's why this is the last race, because everyone's planning on, you know, hitting the road or whatever.
Right.
I'm kind of wondering if they're tying all these things into a longer running arc.
Well, I think the stuff with the Stenza that was one of the things I wanted to talk about.
Well, we can talk about that.
About the remnants.
I wanted to bring that up.
No, yeah,
why is it
you're kind of seeing a connection between this race and the Stenza.
That race definitely has a run-in with the Stenza, because we heard that Angstrom's wife was killed by the Stenza. So,
what do you think, Betsy?
You know, I'm thinking of the roulette, right, in the DC universe, and gangsters.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, the gamesters that, you know,
the supervillain roulette.
Yeah, these always this alien races. They're all about having contests and battles and races. So you wonder if it could be something like that. I was really surprised there was a connection, though very pleased. Like, oh, okay, it isn't a one and done. Charles will be happy. They got another mention of the villains.
The Stenza, yeah.
Yeah. I thought it was an interesting point. I love the very short-lived TV series Drive.
So good.
You know, but then I was a kid, you know, I loved Cannonball Run. And, you know, the Dom DeLuise and Burt Reynolds doing this nothing but just silliness, you know, the idea of you're having this long race and you're getting to the end. And one of the things that happens that we've talked about before is there's all kinds of adventures that happen off screen. So these two people have had this massive adventure that we will never see or hear about.
Right.
And now then they're at the end. So I think that was a great idea. And once again, the Doctor putting things together and building bonds was really smart. And I like the ending. I don't know if I'm jumping ahead too much, but where she convinced them to work together was very smart. I thought that's so the Doctor.
It is, yeah. Okay,
yeah,
I can't get on board if you're into the Cannonball Run 2, though.
It's okay. It's not as good as the first one.
Cannonball Run 1 and done.
Okay.
That's it.
I kind of like 2.
Did you?
I mean, not as good, not as much as the first one, but I like.
Yeah.
Because you had like Jackie Chan in the second one.
Yeah.
Okay, Jackie Chan was a selling point, definitely. I'll give you that.
And, you know,
thank you.
Smokey and the Bandit, you know, and just I love race movies.
Smokey and the Bandit movies were A1. Definitely.
Yes.
Those were good.
Yes.
Eastbound down.
Yes. Rolling up and trucking.
Yes.
So I've apparently I read my wrong title. I was going to be for our third topic. I was going to read Death Race 2018, but apparently, so I'm going to flip it.
Okay.
Just because I'm apparently disorganized here. So third topic now, which was going to be the second topic title, oddly enough, is the Cannonball Run.
Awesome.
Oh, yes. That's very timey-wimey of you, Charles.
Exactly.
I like it.
So all the events happen, just not in the same order, I guess.
Absolutely.
Very wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey. So I want to talk about the Remnants and the Stenza, since we're kind of like heading that way anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And we got some major teases of what promises to be the overall, the overarching storyline for Series 11, even though Chris Chibnall said there's not going to be an overarching storyline.
There is.
Lie. You're a lying liar who lies.
Yeah.
Rule number one, the doctor lies.
Yeah. Rule number two. One,
the showrunner lies.
The showrunner lies. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So that can, makes me put be a little more questioning about whether we're going to see some old monsters. Because mm-hmm. he said there were going to be there wasn't going to be any old monsters, and you know, if you can't trust him, I guess there might be. Just saying. All right, go ahead, Jesse. Yeah. I'm sorry.
No. I just was going to say that. By the way, every time you call them the Remnants,
yes,
I think of the Leftovers.
Yeah. That's just kind of essentially what they are, as we find out.
Fantastic.
That show is fantastic, and talk about Christopher Eccleston shining.
So good.
Yeah.
Well, at least you made a Doctor Who connection there. That's good.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But just every time I hear that, I think of that. Once again, great setup. You see it looks like discarded rags on the sand.
Right.
You know, a couple of times. And then to have them floating almost, you know, like ghosts.
Like, exactly.
It was very creepy, which is always good. Very slick. Just a really nice. And, you know, the robot, killers. And there were some fun villains.
The sniper bots.
Yeah. Really, really fun villains. And I liked it a lot.
I was kind of surprised because they initially did that one like kind of focus of the camera on one of those rags lying in the sand, and I was trying to piece together. I'm like, okay, what's the purpose of this moment that we're getting, this little pause on this thing? What's the purpose of it? And sure enough, there was a purpose, because hey, it turns out that thing was actually sentient. And all swirling around. And apparently, the result is what we find out is that the Stenza wiped out this planet of desolation and made the water bad, the air foul, got all these killer robots and weapons of mass destruction. And this kind of fabric, the sentient fabric, maybe they were doing some kind of experiments or something. I'm kind of wondering. What do you think? What do you guys think?
Maybe. I did want to bring up that Jesse.
Mm-hmm.
You and I talked about a little show called Farscape.
Yes.
I don't know if you remember that time in our lives when we talked about that show.
But, yes.
My husband just said I do. From the other room. He's all the way in the other room. A lot of the episodes were framed with something in the foreground, and then the main part of the shot was in the background.
Right.
And a lot of the Remnant stuff was like in the framing on the foreground. Like it showed like almost the mouth of a building, and then like tatters of these pieces of cloth that were stuck in the doorway. And I thought it was really artsy. And again, it was that kind of placement of, you knew it had to mean something, but you weren't sure what. And I love that sort of foreground background thing. So,
yeah. And I was really creeped out when, the guy's sitting there taking a nap and they're just, it's almost like snakes coming at him, and he's sleeping, and you're just like, wake up, wake up, wake up.
Yeah, it worried me there.
I was okay with it because it was Epso. So I'm just like, yeah, go ahead and kill him.
Well, still, it's very tension building. And
I know.
I was very tense. Really, yes. Very yes. tense watching the episode. Yeah, and
I was too.
Anything that would smother you gets me super anxious. Yeah.
I like that Chibnall's trying to, like, two episodes in, we've gotten some creepy moments in both, and I'm really enjoying that. I want to see more of that.
Yeah, Tim Shaw was definitely foreboding, but this monster who will, like, wrap you up and smother you, that is scary to me. I mean,
it's just this faceless thing.
Right.
That's
like Halloween scary.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. It was just so well done. You're like, yes, that's good. Smart.
Yeah.
You know, it looks really good.
Yeah.
So, yes.
And one of the more interesting things I thought about the remnants was that they take a particular interest in the Doctor by kind of teasing. They kind of warn her that they see the timeless child in her future. So what is the timeless child? And
my noise.
Yeah.
Yes.
Let's see. Let's see if I can
do you have
chip
it?
In. Yes.
There you go. Awesome.
So, yeah, you're welcome. I got you covered. Not as good because it's on my cell phone, but, you know, I got you covered.
Still, right.
So the timeless child. Obviously, this is going to be our big, like, is this like the Jodie Whittaker era's Bad Wolf, perhaps?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
that's what that's the general consensus
we don't know.
They talked about the outcast that's abandoned and alone or something to that effect. If I remember correctly.
Yeah.
There's something brewing in the background. Mm-hmm. Something's brewing.
Yep.
I want to know what it is.
Mystery.
I would have been okay not having a big mystery. I was actually kind of looking forward to just a straightforward, you know, 10 episodes. So if we don't get too crazy into the mythos, I'm going to be okay with it. You know
just... Bad Wolf was like, 2 seasons, right?
Right.
So, yeah. Well, mostly the first, but yeah, we got the payoff eventually.
Right.
Yeah. So, but
I'm just saying.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. I know what you're saying. So, I kind of wonder. I was kind of surprised that they're already teasing something like this, but if nothing else, it's great for the podcast because it gives us something to speculate about, right?
Absolutely.
I'm all in on the speculation.
So, well, everybody, Doctor Who fandom, all the Whovians out there are going to be going, the timeless child, and they're going to be like coming up with all these, like, you'll get that meme of what's his name with the strings all over the room tied to everything. Yeah. You know the one I'm talking about.
A murder board.
Absolutely.
Yes, the murder board. Yeah. So, when all these like threads connecting everything, all conspiracy theory meme. All right. Let's talk about our fourth and final topic this week.
Ooh, that's right. We have bonus content, not 3 topics, 4.
Exactly. Because you only thought you were going to get away with 3, right? Well, no, 4 topics this week.
We get 4. And,
well, I just kind of like, I was in the mood to break this out. 4. Yeah, exactly. Well, there was various things I wanted to talk about. So I thought breaking it up this way, because we have to talk about the TARDIS.
Oh, yes.
And so with that in mind, the title for this segment is Those Magnificent Women and Men in Their Flying Machines.
Very nice.
And that is obviously...
Yes.
You know what? I almost mentioned that movie a few seconds ago. With Terry... Is his name Terry Towers was in that movie?
I've never seen it.
Oh, it's a good movie. It's a very good movie.
It's no Cannonball Run 2.
That is for sure. It's so much better.
Harsh.
It's a very cute movie. It's got Curtis. What's his name? Curtis in it.
That Curtis guy.
You know.
Okay. Tony Curtis.
Tony Curtis. Yes.
Tony Curtis.
Him.
Yeah. Jesse's old. He gets that. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. So, Karen, let's start with you. What's your thoughts on the new TARDIS?
Okay, I had no idea that the Ghost Monument was the TARDIS.
I got sucked in too, so don't feel bad. I totally didn't see that coming.
Yeah. So yeah, that was cool.
Mm-hmm.
That they were actually like headed for this Ghost Monument, and it turned out to be the TARDIS. I love when she said, "Come to Daddy." I mean, come to Mom.
Yeah, come to Mommy.
Yeah, that was great. I like I said earlier, I loved when she said, "I like it," with the Reno, with the Reno.
Yeah.
I love how proud she is of the TARDIS when she shows them around.
Right. She's so eager to show them the TARDIS.
Come in. And look around.
She's all kind of apologetic because last time she saw it, everything was all like all over the place. Things were on fire because every time you change the showrunner now, you have to blow up the console room for some stupid reason.
Yes.
Yeah, I haven't had a chance to pick up.
Yeah, exactly. So as far as she knew.
Keep that in mind. Yeah.
Yeah. But the TARDIS helps.
I really loved it, and I love that she communicated with it and kind of coaxed it to her. I mean, it's like her friend, you know. I love that it's like a part of her, and
well, they are kind of I think bonded,
symbiotic.
Absolutely. Because of just that kind of symbiotic relationship that allows the Doctor to have that influence over the TARDIS and vice versa. Really, I think.
Yeah, it's just so cool. And there was a bit of a hooray when the TARDIS, coalesced, and when she opened the door and everybody walked in. I mean, it was just a great culmination to the episode.
Yeah. Jesse, what was your reaction to that?
Well, I was surprised too. I did not see the monument going, and then when she said, "Oh, that must have been stuck in a time loop," and that makes sense. So we're getting there. And then when you hear the sound, right when the Doctor was discouraged.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, she's, "I failed you guys." And there.
It was that moment of vulnerability
that
was kind of unexpected, I think.
Yeah, and they're telling her, "No, no, no, come on, Doc." You know, and by the way, I love that he calls her Doc.
Right.
I think that is hilarious.
Tegan did too.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden you hear the sound and you see the TARDIS. And I did. I went, "Yes!" you love, and you're right, there is a tenderness and there you are, my old friend. And
don't you want to be alone?
Yeah. And she's looking and she's like, "Oh, you've refreshed." And then when she walks in, and then I'm going to have to get used to the new
pronouns.
No, the new interior.
Yes.
I don't know if I like a hallway going into it where you see the door.
Capaldi had kind of that. And so did Matt Smith's first in TARDIS interior.
Mm-hmm. I didn't remember, but I love the actual console itself.
Right.
I love the hourglass. I love all the levers and pedals. And they didn't say bigger on the inside, but they all implied it. So I thought that was kind of funny that they went it, though. I still love any time when you see them, it's bigger on the inside. The Doctor mouths along. So it was just a wonderful reveal. And the idea, it's a time ship, you know.
Ryan was geeking out, as like, it also travels in time.
Yeah. Really? So that was great. I just love all about it. And it gives you cookies. What more could you want?
Exactly. cream custard cream cookies, which is pretty cool. So it's like a cookie.
Absolutely.
Or as they call them, obviously, overseas, biscuits.
That's right.
Yes.
They're biscuits.
Unless they're often than their cookies.
Right. So there was a lot of little things I loved about this whole sequence. I like the doctor. She's like, she kind of is outside the TARDIS doors, and she kind of apologizes for having lost the key.
Right.
But the TARDIS lets her in.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then, she's kind of looking at that. Jodie Whittaker's just reaction to seeing the TARDIS interior totally sells the scene for me.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
That kind of wide-eyed wonder. Now, I had talked about that. I compared the two TARDIS interior because I had seen it on the interwebs early. And I compared it to, like, the Eighth Doctor's TARDIS interior had a baby with the Superman's Fortress of Solitude.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
Okay. So I can see that.
Does everybody kind of agree with that?
Yeah,
that
I can see
assessment?
That. Sure.
Okay. Yep. Because it's very crystalline.
Yeah,
this TARDIS.
It is a little bit. It is. It's not that hexagonal.
Hexagonal. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hexagonal.
Hexagonal. Yes. Thank you. Yes.
You I got started it off wrong.
No. You were fine. You were fine. You corrected me, so that's cool. But these big crystalline pillars, and it's kind of has more of an organic look again that we haven't seen since Eccleston and Tennant's TARDIS interior.
Right.
The his grunge phase.
Yes.
If you recall correctly. But
it's darker, isn't it? A little darker.
A little darker, but
it is.
Yeah, it's. And depending on the lighting, though, I think because the grunge TARDIS interior could be dark depending on what was going on too, sometimes. So to make it more dramatic, I think. But here, I thought it was very cool and a very cool reveal. So I was very happy with that. And then of course, then we get like theme at the end, and that's all good. That's all good. So
absolutely.
Very, very cool. So we've got our Doctor Who theme. We've got our TARDIS. It's all good, people. We're just like, now everything else is just gravy on top.
That's right. And I guess they decided to stick with her for a little bit. At the end of the episode, they've kind of decided, hey, we don't have to get back right away. So.
Right. Well, I think she's going to try to get them back. But I think there's something, of course, is going to go wrong with the TARDIS navigation, and they're going to end up. Well, you know, they got her. She gets them back to Earth, but maybe not the right time or the right continent. As it turns.
Remember, sexy always takes you where you need to go.
Right, not always where you want to go.
Yes, absolutely.
So that's great. All right. So everybody, anything else about this episode before moving to favorite lines?
I have a couple little things. I'm like the worst, aren't I?
No.
The worst companion. I have a couple little things.
You're not a companion. You're a full-fledged partner in time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. I wrote Chekhov's cigar for the cigar because he brings it out and they make a big show about talking about it. And of course it's going to save the day in the end.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When you're trying to get out of the way of a crashing spacecraft, run to the left or the right.
Exactly. Yeah.
They just ran in a straight path.
I thought of that straight line. Like, what are you doing?
I'd never understood that.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're trying to avoid something, go to the side, not backwards.
Right. Okay. So those two things I just decided I had to. And then there was a moment when the doctor is telling them to run away from the robots. And she says, don't run in a straight line. Okay, number one.
Yep.
She just ran, like, from a crashing. But number two, it made me think of the in-laws. And
I was going to say, but that's exactly what I thought, too. The great Peter Falk, Alan Arkin, serpentine. Yes.
Yep. It jumped into my head. So.
Yeah, that's funny. All right. Anything else?
Nope. That's it.
All right. So, Jesse, let's start with you. We got some favorite lines of the episode.
I'm going to take turns because, there's so many good ones.
Well, we should take turns. I think it's more fair.
But I just love Graham. Eh? Can people and things stop putting stuff inside me without my permission?
Yeah, that was great.
That was one of my favorite quotes. Yes, I just, love that. That was the best line Graham's had for the past two episodes. So yes,
it was just perfect.
So far.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I remember last week I said that Graham is probably the audience's point of view character.
Yeah.
Because that's how you would react. You're like, could aliens stop sticking things in me? That would be great.
Yeah.
And another
yes.
And another great Graham line is when Ryan says, "We're on an alien planet, Graham." And Graham goes, "Well, the three suns in the sky are a bit of a giveaway."
Duh.
Yeah.
Exactly.
All right, Karen, you got one?
Yeah. The doctor says they've shut down the life support systems, depriving us of air. And our favorite companion, Graham, says, "A man could really take against these robots." He is none too pleased.
Yeah.
In his very British way, he says it.
Right.
"A man could really take against these robots."
Yes.
Well, obviously, I love doctor quotes, so I'm going to start with a doctor quote.
Okay.
Where they just landed on Desolation, and she tells her friends, "By the way, welcome to what I presume is your first alien planet. Don't touch anything."
Absolutely, yes.
You never know what will happen.
Exactly. Well, yeah. She just knows what companions do.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Jesse, you got another one?
I like the where he says, "Put the gun down, Ryan. What's your better idea? Outthink them. You can't outthink bullets. Been doing it my whole life." And then afterwards, the doctor said, "Made it worse? Yeah, just a little bit. Now do you see why I don't like guns?"
So, I just love that.
That was good. That was great.
The whole scene.
Yeah.
And I'm glad to see that her doctor taking another good stance against guns.
Yeah.
That feels more like the doctor to me. Mm-hmm. All right, Karen, got another one?
Yeah. Yeah says, "You can't engineer dimensions." And the doctor says, "Maybe you can't."
Yeah. Yes gets the short shrift again.
Yeah, she does.
Yeah.
But she's getting a spotlight episode that I want to talk about when we talk about her Series 11 news.
Okay,
good.
So I got some news on that. So she does get her episode. So she's been kind of underwritten, I think, for the past couple episodes
it's
so far.
It's only been two.
It's only been two. So, yeah, hopefully maybe she'll get more to do in the next one. Another doctor quote I have is she goes, "I'm really good in a tight spot. At least I have been historically. I'm sure I still am."
I love it.
I love that too. And then she said that another nice point was when Ryan and Graham, and Ryan says, "You talk about this stuff way too much." And Graham says, "And you don't talk about it enough." I really liked their relationship. And
Graham's trying really hard.
Yeah, he is really, really trying. Yeah.
Ryan's giving him nothing though.
Yeah, and the other thing
so far, I'm sure that's going to change. We'll probably get a hug by the season finale, I'm guessing.
And, you know, he says, "Are we ever going to talk about your Nan? I mean, just because all this is going on doesn't mean to say it didn't happen. See, I cope myself with asking the question. If Grace was here, what would she say? And Ryan, what would you reckon? Right now, she's saying, what's the matter with you? You're on another planet. How cool is that?"
Right.
And based on Grace, that's exactly what she should say. Yeah. Yes.
Yep. Yeah, that's kind of what I'm a little disappointed that Grace was killed off, because it would have been kind of interesting to see her on an alien planet.
Yes.
That would have been cool.
Karen, any other quotes before
I
move
on? The doctor and Graham are talking about her sunglasses. And the doctor says, "I can't remember who I borrowed them off now. It was either Audrey Hepburn or Pythagoras." And Graham says, "Pythagoras never wore shades." And the doctor says, "You obviously never saw him with a hangover."
Yes.
I love that little scene. And then, of course, Graham with girly sunglasses on. Is
yes. Like, yeah. How great is it that he's wearing like Audrey Hepburn and sunglasses?
He just wore them with so much like, yep, owning it.
He wore the crap out of those sunglasses. Exactly.
He's just like, I don't care what you think. My eyes are protected and yours aren't.
That's right.
Yes.
I'm secure enough in my manhood to wear these sunglasses.
He was shway.
Yeah.
He was rocking it. Real quick, I just had this one line by Ryan, which I thought was pretty poignant, and I like that a lot. He goes, why is it always ladders?
Yeah.
Yes. The doctor, the ship is old school. I'm good at old school. And the other thing, and this is what I was talking about, and you gave the very end of the line, but when the doctor says, right, quick update, I made a terrible mistake. We shouldn't be here. I'm going to fix it and get you guys home. I promise. As soon as I figure out where we are. Graham, how are you going to do it? Not sure. I'm treating it as a chance to surprise myself. And then, oh, by the way, welcome to what I presume is your first alien planet.
Right. Yeah.
You know, she's explaining what's going on. She's still smart. She's still funny. I adore this doctor.
Yeah, me too.
And Jodie Whittaker's timing, comedic timing, really sells this stuff.
Yes, she does.
Yep. All right. So ratings. Karen, let's go with you this time. What's your rating?
I gave it 9 brains before bullets.
Oh, you really liked it just like the first one.
Mm-hmm, I did.
Very nice. How about you, Jesse?
So I'm going back a little bit just because, you know, my gut instinct is 10, 10, 10, 10s.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm going to give it 8.5 big locked doors because I love a big locked door.
Yeah.
Charles is freezing.
Okay, go for it.
Okay. So, everybody, apologies for the glitchiness here, but yours truly lost his internet connection right at the most worst possible moment. So, I'm going to go
it's
ahead
not
and give
the
my
worst.
It's
it
not the worst.
It could have been at the beginning of the episode.
Right, right. So Karen's going to be kind enough to drop this in. So, if it sounds inserted, that's because it is. So, I'm going to go ahead and give my rating for this episode. I give it 8.5 dispense cookies / biscuits.
Awesome.
And obviously, I'm in sync with Jesse on this one.
You are.
And I also want to give a real quick some Series 11 news because thankfully my partners in time covered my ass with finishing up the podcast. So I'm going to do some quick Series 11 news to be dropped in as well. Episode 4 coming up is Arachnids in the UK. And this is going to feature the Doctor, Yaz, and Graham and Ryan finding their way back to Yorkshire and Yaz's family only to find something is stirring amongst the 8-legged arachnid population of Sheffield. So, ooh, creepy crawling spiders. But I do like the kind of little play on the term anarchy in the UK with arachnids in the UK.
Yeah.
Very clever.
That is clever, but I'm not going to like that episode, I don't think.
Neither is my wife, Lori.
Yeah.
Episode 5, the Saranga Conundrum, which is going to have injured and stranded in the wilds of a far-flung galaxy, the Doctor, Yaz, Graham, and Ryan must band together with a group of strangers to survive against one of the universe's most deadly and unusual creatures.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. And lastly, episode 6 is going to be called Demons of the Punjab.
Ooh.
And we're going to travel to India, 1947, where the Doctor and her friends arrive in the Punjab as the country is being torn apart. While Yaz attempts to discover her grandmother's hidden history, the Doctor discovers demons haunting the land. Who are they and what do they want?
Okay, that sounds cool.
Yeah, so finally getting a good Yaz spotlight on episode 6, in case everybody's been wondering. So apologies again, but thanks to Karen and thanks to Jesse for covering my big epic fail. So
your internet,
everybody,
it was your internet, it wasn't yours.
It was yes. So here's the rest of the episode, and thanks for listening, guys.
Do we want to close it? And then I know we won't have his reverse polarity, but so we at least could get the podcast finished. Yes, I will give you. We did have one feedback. Holly Mack said, "Hey, Charles, Jesse, and Karen.
Oh, hi.
I love the new cover art for the podcast and the Facebook page. I really enjoyed this episode. Loved the opening credit sequence." Another person who loves the credits. At first, when the doctor and the company landed on that planet, the one ship looked like something that would fit right at home in Star Wars. Love that Graham and Ryan started to talk about Grace and how they were dealing with her loss. When Lynn was giving the rundown of the planet's dangers, I was wondering if they hadn't landed on an alternate version of Mars. Didn't see the ghost monument being the TARDIS. My mind went right to a Mars-shaped pyramid at first. Also love the use of the Venezuelan Aikido.
There we go.
Yep, the end scene with the TARDIS in its interior. Wow. I loved it. Loved Yaz, Graham, and Ryan's reaction to being inside the TARDIS for the first time. Can't wait for their next adventure together. I'll wrap it up here. Holly from Wisconsin. As always, thank you, Holly.
Thanks, Holly.
Yeah. So, Karen, if someone wants to reach you, how can they? But you know what? For old school, I am on Twitter at JesseJacksonDFW. You can reach us at NextStopEverywhereSMG. And Karen can be reached at Alevaria, A-L-E-V. I can't say it without laughing.
I know you can't.
Yeah.
We are NextStopEverywhereSMG at gmail.com. We are Facebook.com/NextStopEverywherePodcast. NextStopSMG on Twitter. Charles Skaggs on Twitter. Jesse Jackson DFW on Twitter. And Aleveria, A-L-E-V-E-R-I-A on Twitter. You can listen and subscribe to us in Apple Podcasts. And please leave us a review.
Yes, we would love to do that. Karen, hopefully Charles was not, caught by a monster. I am thinking, I agree with you. I think it's power. Yeah. But we will end with, there's a lot of things you need to get across the universe. Warp drive, wormhole refractors. You know the thing you need most of all? You need a hand to hold. And I'm so glad that I have Charles in your hands as I go through this.
Aww.
Thank you, listeners. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Charles, wherever you are. Right. We'll talk to you soon.
In the recorder now.
And Jesse, be quiet.
Yeah. No talkie. At the beginning and the end. No, I'm not going to get upset.
Okay.
I would never.